Good morning, all, and welcome to the November 5th meeting of the Board of Barnstable County Regional Commissioners. And please join us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please join us in a moment of silence as we remember all the men and women who serve in our armed forces, both here and abroad, and for all those who have given their lives for us. Thank you. So we'll start with public comment. Is there anyone here who would care to speak on any item not on the agenda? Mr. Morse,
sure.
Welcome.
What's your protocol? Stand, sit?
You can sit if you like.
Okay.
Yeah.
I have 90 seconds for you.
You have 3 minutes,
okay.
Actually.
Okay. Please cut me off. I'd like to give you a very brief update on the status of the classification and compensation plan. I know it's been a while. We're at the final stages of writing the report, it's been an arduous process because in one sense it has been because the county system is so good. We were hired to do two things, to look at the classification plan, which is a relationship between positions, and then to take a look at the pay plan, did they make sense in relation to that classification plan. The original plan was developed in 1998. It has been very consistently maintained, in fact, aggressively maintained by county staff. They've looked at about 50 positions through the years when we requested for classification. We went actually all through it. They did a really good job. So if we look at it today, the system is pretty good. It's in place. The relationships are good. We have some recommendations on that, but they're not recommendations I would find earth-shattering in that sense. So the classification plan is pretty good. In fact, very good, much better than we typically see. We looked at the salary plans. To do that, we had to do a salary survey. As you know, this is somewhat of a unique organization, so we used some cases for certain positions, some cities and towns. An example would be some on the Cape. Plymouth was on it since it's a large one, and they have some similar positions. We looked at the regional planning agencies. We looked at a couple of the council of governments locally. Went to the state, the Unit 9 positions, which are scientists, engineers, and planners. And we looked at one point we had to go to UMass and we looked at the extension positions to see what they paid, to give us some data on the registries and some of the other counties and so on that we had. If you look at your groups of positions, your MP and management and planning, your ML, which are the mechanical and labor, OC, office, occupational, and the supervisory, professional and technical positions, and any other positions, you are competitively paid. What I mean that, if you look at the middle of the labor market, you're pretty much right in the middle of the labor market for all those groups of positions. So as I understood the policy, the idea was always to be close to the middle. Well, you've been close to the middle, you stuck that way, and you maintain the plan. So in summary, classification plan looks good, some recommendations, pay plan is pretty good, you all fit in there. I would not really make a lot of changes, if any at all, to the pay plan. So I thought it was a pretty good work condition.
Bill?
Many years ago, I was part of the federal system, and one of the things that we looked at was something called regional board classifications.
Yes.
Okay. And that, so the question I would have is that, based upon the cost of living here, in addition to looking at competitive prices for similar jobs in other areas, did you take that into account?
Yeah, actually, finally, after a lot of work, we focused largely on, you would say, this area of Massachusetts, although we had looked out beyond that a little bit to some of the positions. To be frank, we looked at the state positions, which really weren't high paid, many of them. I always try to consider that because there's really kind of three labor markets in Massachusetts. One is really the Cape Cod labor market, the second is the Boston, and then everything else if you take a look at the labor markets. They have kind of moved together in recent years, but we did try to take into consideration. Housing costs are high. It's consistent to much of the Boston metro market, depends how you look at it, but they're close there too.
Okay, well,
We really can't go into this today because this is a public comment. But we will have
I'll be back on the 19th.
Yeah, and we're going to present. This is just.
And at that time, those would be issues, how do we offset the housing, say, the impact of housing costs, and also whether or not the classification that we, you know, that we have takes into account, you know, some of the other issues with regard to cost of living, especially with the cost of daycare with regard to young families. So anyway, those are all things that
we can discuss. So not a problem.
Okay, thank you.
I'm Deputy Chair. Pleasure.
Thank you, Mark, very much. Anybody else? Well, it's public comments. So. Thank you. Anybody else like to speak under public comment? If not, I think we will move to our regular agenda, and we're going to have a status report on the Water Protection Collaborative from Andrew Gottlieb, Executive Director. Welcome, Andy.
Recording.
We all survived the election yesterday, sort of. We're contemplating the results and not commenting. Huh?
There you go.
Right.
The Republic will survive.
Yes.
So just, you know, quick summary sort of where we've been in the last 10 months, I think our activities sort of break down to a couple of areas. You know, obviously the activities related to the 208 planning process. Collaborative's primary role, twofold in that. One was we reconstituted the Technical Advisory Committee to provide guidance and support to the 208 process around, in particular around the issue of valuation and vetting the various 40-odd alternative wastewater management control technologies and approaches that are incorporated in the report. And we invited representation from every one of the 15 towns onto that technical advisory committee. A slight majority of the towns took us up on that offer. We had some really good working sessions with that group. And I think that contributed to some of the strength and acceptance of the technologies matrix. So that was a really good opportunity to use the structure that the collaborative provided to get municipal input into that process, and that fed into the larger advisory discussion that went on. And then it's been a good, collaborative has been a good venue to provide engagement for the towns outside of the watershed team process, so that, you know, on a regular basis, you know, meetings now start off with a 208 update, so that those selectmen, you know, the majority of the board still being comprised of selectmen, give them an opportunity to hear directly what's going on, bring that back to their communities, and get input from their communities back into the process. So I think that piece has functioned reasonably well. We spent a fair amount of time this year working with our legislative delegation on enhancements to wastewater management at the state level in two specific bills that passed the legislature in July of this year, Water Infrastructure Bill and the Environmental Bond Bill. And there was a lot in those two bills combined that benefit communities on the Cape, and I think, you know, the collaborative had a fair degree of input into that. There were, just by way of summary, on the money side, a couple of authorizations in the bond bill that directly benefit the work that we're doing down here. One was a $4.5 million authorization for state contribution toward municipal costs for implementing alternative wastewater control methodologies. And the idea behind that funding is to mitigate some of the risk of towns' experience in piloting some of these alternatives, because, you know, the 208 report bounds the high and low expected outcomes from any one of these measures, but we don't know exactly within the range where performance is going to fall in a specific application on Cape Cod. And, you know, so a town investing in that is undertaking some degree of risk, not knowing whether they're going to end up at the high end, the low end, somewhere in the middle. And so this funding authorization does provide some state cost share to mitigate some of that risk. And the legislature adopted as eligible projects every technology that was included in the matrix. They basically adopted the matrix as the eligibility criteria. So that's a positive thing. And it's reflective of a general trend in the legislation this year that embedded the outcome of the 208 process in state statute, either as a basis for the awarding of financial assistance, whether it's for this bond money or for the SRF, or in terms of permitting and process, so that we saw a lot of progress in that regard. So there's $4.5 million for alternative technologies, there's $4 million bond authorization for the next round of water quality monitoring and modeling. So as we move forward and we begin to put measures in place, both specific to the individual measure, understanding what its performance is, and then more broadly what the trends are in water quality changes, there's a pot of state money that's available to help communities and the county move forward with that. We'll talk about how we're going to approach that again in a minute. Just for clarity, these bond authorizations aren't real cash. They're subject to inclusion in the annual state capital spending program that's determined each spring by the governor, and so now at least we know who the governor's going to be, and we can start those conversations accordingly in short order. But if you don't get the authorization, you can't get the money. It's a two-step process. You can't get included in a capital spending plan unless you get an authorization upon which to draw. We got the authorizations, now we have to have the discussion with the administration, incoming administration, about the priority and importance of these measures, and we'll start that process. So it's not real money, but if you don't get the authorization, you can't play in the game. So we're in the game, and that's a good thing. It's a five-year authorization. You can go back over time, and if you don't succeed the first time, you can continue to pursue that. The other things in the legislation are changes around financing is that they cooked into the criteria of the SRF consistency with the 208 plan. And that's important for our communities in that it provides statutory certainty that projects that are consistent with the 208 plan and projects that move ahead on a targeted watershed basis in the absence of a comprehensive plan, townwide plan, those projects are clearly identified as eligible for 0% interest under the pre-existing authorization that we obtained 5 or 6 years ago. Took away some lack of clarity there. And also consistency with 208 is a statutory basis for the Commonwealth to provide principal forgiveness, which is a method now that's included in the statute that provides the opportunity for up to 25% grant equivalency on an SRF loan. So that's an important step for us to have that included by statute. And then a series of changes in the State Clean Waters Act so it specifically enabled the Commonwealth to issue a permit on a watershed basis and to incorporate in that permit a lot of measures that heretofore were not something that required a permit. And so you can now get a permit that says we're going to reduce our load, you know, 25% from treatment, 25% from reactive barriers, 25% from you know, oyster or shellfish propagation, and the remaining from non-point source controls, including fertilizer. You can get a permit now that says these are the allocations and get credit for things that in the past, before July, couldn't be permitted under a groundwater discharge permit, and therefore you couldn't get credit for them for the purposes of compliance with the federal TMDL. Now you can. So the framework that we needed in order to take these watershed plans that are considered in the 208 plan and actually get them administratively converted into an enforceable permit that gives you credit for moving forward now exists. It's a huge change in statute. So we spent a lot of time working on that over the course of the spring and summer. Very successful. I think offer prospect of, you know, realizing the cost savings that are contemplated in the 208 plan. And along with financial assistance changes that came in the SRF, provide the ability to help support that fundamentally, financially for the community.
So does that translate into funds from the SRF being available for these other types of projects that are not sewer related?
Yes. I mean, there always was non-point source eligibility. Mm-hmm. but you now have the ability to point back to their derivation in a 208 plan and get both credit for inclusion and more favorable financing terms than were otherwise possible under, before the statute was changed.
One of the questions that comes up to me is how many SRF projects actually got underway during
Do we have now?
Yeah.
Not very many.
Okay. And then what is the deadline for that, you know?
It's an annual process, Bill. The funding is available on a calendar year cycle.
Mm-hmm.
Typically, DEP solicits projects in the early summer of each year for inclusion in the following year's list.
Yeah, it's like the NPO.
It's a tip.
But the real question is, there was a deadline on that SRF.
The legislation 6 years ago, in 2009, that created the zero interest provision, and I'm glad you reminded me of this, had a 2019 sunset.
Mm-hmm.
One of the ways the legislature acknowledged the role of 208 in what we're doing is that the 208 process contemplates a 50-year implementation cycle so that we can spread these things out. Legislature adopted that funding cycle and extended the deadline, the existence of the 208 or the 0% interest financing to 2069.
Okay.
So there's an annual funding cycle. Now, do I expect it to stay this way for the next 55 years? Probably not.
We live in the present.
But it's an important signal that the legislature is adopting and approves of the fundamental approach that we've adopted in the 208 cycle.
Okay.
So that's a good thing. In terms of, so 208 work, the legislative work, and then, ongoing support to our member towns. We've continued to provide direct support through the municipal assistance appropriation that you folks have supported in the areas, in specific areas of technical assistance and financial management. We've continued to provide third-party consulting services to a handful of communities that have requested it, and that continues to be something that's been a useful service. It's down a little bit because the degree of engagement that the communities have had around the 208 cycle and some of the support they were getting is coming through that now. So I've seen that tick down just a wee bit. But we also the board adopted a policy this year of providing direct financial assistance to communities for projects that serve not only that individual community's needs, but provide information or lessons learned that are broadly applicable to multiple communities on the Cape. And to that end, we provide some direct financial, ongoing financial assistance to the town of Wellfleet and its culch program for shellfish propagation, and are getting very good results from that, and that's feeding into some of the discussion about how you assess the benefits of shellfish propagation as part of a nitrogen control strategy. So we've done that, and we provide some fairly substantial assistance to Falmouth on a couple of pilot projects that they're working on related to understanding where and how to site reactive barriers, how far, sort of the relationship between distance from the water, from the edge of the water, depth to groundwater, and how you understand the relationship between those two things so that you can understand what your flexibility is in terms of putting reactive barriers back off the edge of the water because of some of the both the wetlands impacts and access to property. And that has fairly broad applicability to a number of different sites. So we've been using money that way. And we've also, one other study that we've worked on is, to work with MBL around the changing role and the changing rate of atmospheric deposition of nitrogen, and how, and understanding some broader trends on the changes in nitrogen deposition with precipitation, and what that tells us about how we should or shouldn't think about managing the loads that happen, controllable loads on the land. And that has huge implications to work that every town's doing.
Okay. actually, two questions. One on, there's some questions as far as airborne nitrogen deposition has a different character or quality to it than, you know, than nitrogen that, you know, that comes from groundwater. And I don't know what effect that has. But and the other question is, there was some concern a couple of years ago about the so-called intellectual
property around MEP.
The property business.
Yeah.
And it affected the town that I live in, you know, Harwich. And I'm wondering, is there any, you know, how is that working out? Because it was directly connected to, you know, to all of this.
Right.
You know, that Harwich's program was, you know, was put back kind of severely. And you mentioned two projects, one in Wellfleet, one in Falmouth.
Yeah.
So I might as well put my oar in for what's going on in Harwich.
Harwich, we've provided direct assistance on the financial management side a couple of times. Harwich has come back and used, you know, Bob Seoler a couple of different times, has used him in this current fiscal year, or this calendar, you know, over the course of this calendar year. It's actually the last fiscal year, to help them, you know, evaluate some of their financing options. In terms of the question about, you know, the atmospheric deposition, that's precisely the work that we're funding to understand what's going on there. There has been apparently an observed decrease in atmospheric nitrogen deposition over the last decade. I'm trying to understand what that's all about, you know, whether it's a result of cleaner air because of the air quality standards that are going in for power plants, and you're getting a little bit less, whether it's change in fuel mix as things move from coal and oil to cleaner burning natural gas. Does it have to do with changes in airflow as a result of some, you know, larger changes in global warming patterns, climate change? We're getting more of our air from you know, Canada as opposed to coming out through the central part of the United States. And you know, what are those trends and how are they, how reliable are they and what do they mean?
Okay, well, you're referring, as I hear that, to the quantity of deposition. I'm talking about the characteristics. Are there other things that are in airborne nitrogen that, you know, that do not appear in, you know, in
you know, we're not doing anything specific on that part of the science at the moment. You know, the way the MEP technical reports, and then as a result, the state and federal TMDLs characterize things. They sort of manage controllable loads and non-controllable loads.
Okay.
And so the atmospheric deposition piece is considered not a controllable load. It's not within the ability of any one town, frankly, any one state, to control what comes down the rain. Right?
Yeah.
So okay. It's like, all right, so that's off to the side. It's considered a base part of the load that you can't control. And so, you know, you try and manage the rest of it, you know, which means you have to, because you can't control some portion of it, you have to take a larger percentage of the part that's within your control, which is the land-based stuff that we're contributing, or whatever we're putting in or on the ground. We're not reconsidering and re-looking at that way of thinking about it. That study's not intended to look at that. It's really trying to refine, you know, are the numbers around control versus non-control correct? Have they changed? Why have they, if they've changed, why have they changed, and how reliable is that change? Is it a blip, in which case you just kind of ignore it? Is it part of a longer-term trend, in which case you want to take account for it? We don't know the answers to that yet. It's going to be a little bit of time. In terms of the intellectual property question, you know, it's really a contractual issue between DEP and University of Massachusetts.
Is it affecting us?
Is it affecting you? Yeah, does it matter? All that much? Probably not. You know, it's an issue. It irritates the hell out of a lot of people.
Me included.
At the end of the day, I'm not sure it changes the outcome very much. It changes how people feel about it.
Well, it.
I guess, but
it's a gut issue with regard to we paid for it once with our money, and the fact that they're, you know, they're sort of discussing this. Two government agencies discussing among each other as to who owns it. Really is counterintuitive.
Yeah, I think going forward, and then sort of, you know, following along with the sort of the notes on what I was giving you wanted to hear about, the sort of the big operational change that I think we're going to be thinking about that'll feed into the budget process is longer term monitoring. And, you know, I think that you all supported a supplemental appropriation last fiscal year that gave us resources to fund through contract now with Provincetown Center for Coastal Studies, you know, the Sentinel Station water quality monitoring on the south side of the cave. So you, what you've got now is a system where by contracts and different funding sources, you've got three different contracts governing which side of the water quality monitoring, depending on which side of the cave you're on. Provincetown Center is at the middle of all of it because they tend to, they're the contracting agent. They're working with us on the south side. They're working on state appropriated money on the north side, and they're working in collaboration with Buzzards Bay Coalition on the Buzzards Bay side. And I think with this move towards adaptive management that's incorporated in the 208 plan, the availability of an appropriation for capital authorization at the Commonwealth, one of the things we're talking about is, you know, is this a time and is it appropriate to consolidate this monitoring program, you know, with the county playing a significant role, so that some of those issues about data ownership, collection, access can get solved in a way that addresses some of these concerns about that people have had about the old way data was managed, and puts us in a position that there's a lot of access and transparency as we begin to implement these watershed plans, so people can understand what's happening in the water quality. And so, you know, as part of 208, we've got a water quality monitoring group that's looking at the monitoring protocols. Collaborative is on its agenda. We're going to start the conversation in our November meeting next Wednesday. But what is the right role? Where would it live? How would it be funded and the like? And I think there's an expectation building that, you know, this is probably the year to start talking about bringing all that effort together in one place, thinking about how to store it and provide access to it. So I think that operationally, if I look ahead, something that we might want to change and expand, it'd be morphing that monitoring program into something that the county has a central role in. Not necessarily just sort of telling everybody how it's going to happen, but ensuring that it is done in a consistent manner and is readily accessible to anybody who has interest and questions about what's happening, how, what kind of results are we seeing, and what does that tell us about what the next step and the step after that would be for water quality.
Well, just anecdotally, it's always troubled me because when I was doing USAID front-end feasibility study, we never owned the data because the feds paid for it. So it was, you know, it went into the public domain for, you know, for access for everybody.
Right.
And the fact they have two agencies doing that, you know, just as, you know.
So I mean, I think our strategy has been, you know, the MEP stuff at the end of this fiscal year, by and large, be done. Mm-hmm. We'll have, you know, they will have done almost all their technical reports, with the exception of one community that hasn't put up its local share, and those aren't done. And I don't know what's going to end up happening with those.
Okay.
But other than that, it's all pretty much done. The processing of the TMDLs from DEP to EPA is behind the production of those reports. And the lingering effects of the lawsuit have played into how EPA has chosen to process and approve additional TMDLs and what they've told the state to give them or not give them. So the UMass Dartmouth thing about ownership and like, it's yesterday, to my mind, in many respects, it's yesterday's fight. And, you know, it's more productive discussion to say if we're going to go forward on the next round of modeling, and we're going to forward on the next round of data collection and evaluation, how do we want it to be? And let's set that up the right way. To the extent that UMass would have a role in that, and they'd want to participate in it, then they'd need to enter that negotiation on terms that we set, not fighting the old fight.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd rather just say, whatever. They settled it with the EPA, however they settle it. Going forward, we're not going to fall into that trap again. We're going to set it up in a way that makes sure that it's ownership's clear, it's publicly oriented, and it's transparent to the public and the community leaders who want to see it. And if they want to participate on that basis, I would welcome them in on that discussion. if they can't see their way clear to do it then there's other players out there that we can utilize.
Can I ask just one other thing, going back to the quality of the air and its impact on the land, and Bill mentioned the National Seashore. They had an atmospheric study. They had a organization, I'm not sure if it was an international or the National Atmospheric, and they had done a year collection around the National Seashore. So there's some...
There's a lot of data out there.
Yeah, I'm sure there is. But that's the most recent, and I'm sure that's available, and you can tap right into that from through George. So
the goal is still to have a monitoring program that's consistent, throughout all the Cape towns. Mm-hmm. It's collected in the same manner.
Yep.
And then it's stored, say at the SIO or someplace like that.
Someplace. I mean, we have to figure out what the public interface with that data is.
Mm-hmm.
I think the objective going into it, we haven't talked it all through, is anything and everything we collect, people can see.
Mm-hmm.
And then, what layers of interpretation you put onto it is something, because there's a lot of data out there that's being collected under the three contracts that are being done. The contract we did with Provincetown Center has them providing us with a web-ready public view of that data by January, I believe, sometime this winter. We'll look at that, we'll see how it feels, we'll probably test it out with some people and say, and that could end up being the template that we utilize for all of it. But, it's a little crazy that the data we get, because we're paying for it and we specified it in the contract for the south side, I'm going to assume that the view that they're going to give us is going to be something that everybody's going to, is going to be liked and well accepted. There's no reason why the north side data and the west and Buzzards Bay data should be available on any platform that's different from that.
Mm-hmm.
And yet, those are being funded out of different sources of money. And so those came along with whatever strings they came along with. I think objectively, it makes sense to me intuitively that we would have all our data for all our waters run through the same public interface.
Mm-hmm.
And best way to do that is to obviously, have some role in paying for it, because then you can set the standard the way you want to set the standard. But we're going to work that through. That'll be embedded. I'm not sure what exactly the timing on the budget cycle is going to be. I don't know that we're going to be completely done with that, but I would prepare you for the notion that at a minimum we put in a space holder for some resources, and maybe it's going to be rejiggering what we have to allow for it. It may be that it ends up requiring something additional. I don't know at this point.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's fair to assume that because we've talked about it for several months, that our recommendation to you is going to expand in some form the county's role in the monitoring program. And exactly how the numbers play out, I don't know yet. I haven't heard anybody say it's a bad idea at this point.
No, I haven't either. As a matter of fact, even in the 208 discussions, it seems that is the one thing that people kind of attach to. They get that and they think it's good, and so is this program started? And it's like, okay, but I guess we will, because there is a real strong public.
Yeah. I mean, we're very sensitive to concerns people have about county overstepping its role, but
this
one seems to be that most people could say that makes a hell of a lot of
sense.
Right,
yes.
That's something that is a county scale activity, and all it does is support the local decision making process. It doesn't undermine it in any way.
Yeah, it's a support service and the information service.
Bill?
The issue is, if we weren't doing this, who would be doing it?
Well, until the county stepped in, no one was going to do the south side.
And I think that the point has to be emphasized over and over again, that the contribution from the regional government is to move projects along that benefit all of the individual municipalities here in the Cape. And since no one of them wants to or has exhibited any, I won't use the word interest, but commitment to actually doing something, I think that the role of the county is reinforced and enhanced because we have.
I mean, one of the underlying, and I'll leave you with this thought, one of the underlying premises behind the 208 work is it relies on monitoring and data and reassessment. And sort of the way to unlock the savings that come from only doing what you have to do is having enough information to be able to demonstrate that what you're doing is leading to success. And so it's a penny-wise, pound-foolish example that if you don't invest in the monitoring and save yourself a little bit of money, you're going to pay for it many times over on the back end because you're not going to be able to make a case that what you're doing, the minimalist approach that you're taking, is what's necessary, and you don't need some of the margin of safety that would otherwise be required by the regulators in the absence of good information. So it's crazy not to make that investment.
That's a good thought. Okay.
That's where we are.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Very much. That's very helpful. Okay. Biggest project we have going, so best we stay on top of it.
Okay.
Thanks, Andy. Darlene Johnson Morris is here, Director of Resource Development. I think along with this is about a status report on resource development and AmeriCorps. That's why you're here, Darlene.
Yes. Hello.
Of course, we love AmeriCorps, so we always like to hear all the good things that AmeriCorps is doing.
Thank you.
I brought you a folder.
Thanks.
I don't know if you all have this report to the community we put out. I think I do.
Yeah, I think I've seen this. Yes, I've seen this.
We're just talking about an overview of what mm-hmm. we're doing mm-hmm. to date, and I have put in here in a folder the grant development report, which is goes back through 14. Up to 15, some of the grants overlap, so I put some of the older pages on here so you can see where we were on top of the grants that we're submitting in terms of the development part of the resource development. We're right now we've been holding planning and visioning sessions on building the grant development portion of the resource development office. There's a lot of opportunities out there, not only to build the capacity of the county departments, but as well as building the capacity of the towns through writing grants. I continue to thank the commissioners for the grant writing cash match of money we have. That is always it's an opportunity for us to match through the county many of the town projects or the projects that are coming forward that we're going to put in on a grant in on. It increases and leverages our chances of getting the grant. So that's very helpful. It's very hard to get. I mean, you can use matching that's through staff and through other in-kind services, but I have found that the most attractive type of leverage that we have is having that cash match put up on these different projects. So that's what's going on. We have a new grant writer who had just started because we had Catherine Garofoli left, and so we've replaced her, and we are trying to build back our grant development and writing component. With that, what we did is came up with a capacity building grant that we wrote. You rarely see these. The Cape Cod Community Foundation had a fund that was available for capacity building. We put in a capacity building grant for $20,000 and matching it with $20,000 from the county for an internship program. That internship program would bring in two interns that would write grants and help with research and help with technical assistance to the departments and to the towns, so we can increase the number of grants that we're able to write for our community. I think that it also goes into an opportunity to increase the capacity of the department, so that, say, there was a particular department that needed an intern to work on a few projects that were resource development in nature, we would be able to assign that intern over a six-month period. So we thought 2 months, and then bring in two more interns after those 6 months to keep that going. And if this turns out to be what I think it could be in terms of resources, I'd like to increase that, so that any given time the departments could have an intern that was working on their resource development office or resource development needs. So any types of grants, looking for funding sources, doing research, providing project development, program design, and technical assistance to the departments. I hope we get the grant. If we didn't, I'm really still very invested in the project. I was thinking about putting some money into the budget just to try it out, as you know, to see how it would work as an internship, and have the resource development office be the intern resource for the departments, and so that we could have that intern capacity to offer them on different things that would build the capacity of the individual departments based on what their needs were. So that's one of the interesting components we're doing. We're also having the continuation of operations, kind of training, cross-training of staff, so that we're able to have the operation continue depending on, or if anything should happen to anyone else, we can continue the operation through this cross-training, so we have that. And these are playing into a standard operating procedures that we're having. We're setting systems down for each one of the resource development office. The new manual, we're going to set a new standard for the grant management manual. And we're working with the finance department to finally approve that through the Munis system and some of the changes that have been made. We've been using this system now where there's a manual to manage county grants, and along with that is a binder on each grant that is managed, and then that is in turn assigned to a grant manager, and that's how we do it now. But we do realize that we need to train county staff again for whoever the grant contact people are on the grant, and update our system, so we're in the process of doing that. The AmeriCorps program is doing well. We have 32 members. As you know, we are we sent in a concept paper. Now this is the last year of a three-year grant cycle that we're in right now, so we're going to be submitting a grant. We've been invited to put in a concept paper, and now we're invited to put the full proposal in to the corporation for full funding again for the next 3 years. So that's what we're putting together now. They become more and more competitive. It seems like it's always just something easy. It's not. They're really drilling down on many of the performance measures that we have that we're trying to put really work on our performance measures to clearly define how we are attached to the needs of the community. So we spent a lot of time with an evaluation that was conducted last year by Suffolk University that put the needs, making sure that we're on track with what the critical needs are for Barnstable County that we've previously defined, and our advisory board helps us also with that. I have a list of the grants that we manage in here. I've also put a list of the pie chart that you can kind of see that gives you an overview of the AmeriCorps funding, so that you can kind of get a sense of where we are and where we've been, and the projected total value of service. We use the independent tech sector to come up with this pie chart, but I think it's a visible way to really clearly see how much AmeriCorps has contributed to the service that we have completed in our communities, and we want to continue that. And what you see here also is a individual placement. These are where the members are placed. The member schedule, as you know, has Monday and Fridays are group service projects. Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday can be an individual placement, with one day being their COD day, which is the community outreach day. That day is designed for members to be in the office, and then they in turn work on our signature event. Our first signature event of the year is always Martin Luther King Day, which would be coming up in January, and they're working on that currently. We did receive that grant. We submitted a grant to the Service Alliance to pay for food to be for youngsters who receive the free food lunch period when they're out on vacation. They don't receive that, so there's this would deliver groceries to those those participants would receive, those kids would receive food during that time. That's part of what we're doing for Martin Luther King Day, along with a lot of other nutritional types of service activities and work with food banks. So, and then I have here also for you a kind of like overview of Community Outreach and Development Day, so you can get a sense of what kinds of service activities were involved in here. And I think that's great. An overview of what we're doing.
When we went to...
excuse me.
Yep.
I did ask to...
Go ahead.
Three things. You've already mentioned looking at your capacity for, let's say, for responding to grants. Have you missed any grants because of lack of capacity of matching funds?
No. Matching funds?
Yeah. We've had that in the budget for some time, and you've used it. My question is, since we've never examined that, is this the time to take a look at whether or not the capacity of that, you know, let's say of that pot of money should be increased based upon activity, lost opportunity?
No, I don't think we've had any lost opportunities, okay. Though. I really don't. I think if anything, I want to build the number of folks that are out there to build those. I think there could be more opportunities with more staff writing.
Yes.
That's what I think.
Yeah. Okay.
And so that's why the internship piece. And then, you know, if the cash match money then becomes an issue. Right now it's not, I think, but I think we can do more. We can do more writing and more technical assistance and more resource development types of things. And I think this is I hope this grant is funded. We'll know by the end of December whether it is or not. The initiative is good. I might put a marker or something into the budget to see that if we could at least get it started, I might be able to, you know, kind of work it another way if we're not funded through the Cape Cod Community Foundation.
And then the second question has to do with the, with food given out during vacation times or times when school isn't available for the kids that are on the free lunch program.
Mm-hmm.
I've had some concern as to, we've had several agencies that, you know, at the county that have had responsibility of that from time to time. Cooperative Extension, Human Service, and now you're doing, you know, this one little piece. Is there a need to coordinate that by, you know?
Oh, absolutely. Everything, you know, AmeriCorps does nothing alone. I mean, we are looking at who does it best, who does it most, and collaborating is always what we're doing. So we're working closely with the Cooperative Extension and other groups. We don't want to duplicate or take over anything that somebody's doing. Yes, Bill, we're working collaboratively with all of them on this project.
Thank you.
If all of them involved.
Shelley?
Yeah.
No, I was just going to say, when we were there is that component of the AmeriCorps program that's, you know, that goes into the schools, that is the city, you know, the city program. And I said, well, gee, you know, you don't have to be a city to have a need like that. Have we ever explored and bringing that type of volunteer service on top of the environmental?
Yeah, we have been in the schools and we've been involved with, you know, community service in the schools. And some of the schools have actually, like the town of Barnstable had an individual placement where we were working with, you know, and we've done after-school programs and that type of thing.
And we've had them in on a different grant. What's the name of it? Not just a merit, not the environmental, but we've had them in, it's under the same auspice of the volunteer, the core. But they came with it. We had two writers that came, Vista. Yeah, they came under the Vista banner. So,
Yeah, this is the other thing is that there's, you know, like the town of Mashpee is their human services department. An example of, there are some opportunities out there that I think are available to some areas. Mashpee Human Services might be one where we could write for a Vista volunteer. We wrote for a Vista volunteer to create Cape Cod Volunteers.
Right.
And we also wrote one for our own human services department to have a Vista volunteer. Mm-hmm. They're very, very competitive, and they're based on, you know, the poverty levels and what your targets are. So I do think that there's opportunities, and we're looking into those opportunities for those towns that would be eligible. Mm-hmm. There's some, like I said, we're going to start out with this. This is a thought, we haven't even talked to Mashpee about this yet, but it's been, we've been meeting with them and trying to talk with them about how we can better build the capacity of Mashpee to work with some of their human service needs. So this would be one of them, and Vista volunteers are great ones to get that started. So we'll be looking at that for the town.
Yeah, there's a lot of ways we could do
service initiatives. We also have 10%, still we do this and it's still underway, 10% of the member time can be used for fundraising as long as it's fundraising towards what they are doing. So if they're at an individual placement in Harwich and they're responsible for, you know, the Conservation Trust, they're working with Mike Locke and there's a project, and they can write a grant that's relative to that project and get that. And we help them. We do a grant 101 training with them. So in some ways, this is still underutilized. Members are still, we still have a lot we could get from them. So we continue to try to build that as well, because that resource is then turned out to be a resource to the community. So
yeah, and it's experience for them going forward.
Right, so, I really hope that this internship piece, you know, works out, because I really do think that interns through the Resource Development Office could be really a capacity building opportunity for not only the towns, but for the county departments. And then on the continuation of operations and also succession planning, I plan to put in an increase in the position, one of the positions in the Resource Development Office, to a deputy director type of thing, and training and working with someone who would be able to take on some of those responsibilities should I retire at some point.
At some point,
future.
Those things do happen.
I think that's a very important point that she's making.
Yes.
Is that continuity in every organization has to really be generated from inside, mm-hmm. as opposed to saying you ought to do something about it. Mm-hmm. And I hope that, you know, as part of the budget process.
Our county administrator has been working with the staff department heads on succession planning.
I saw some of that.
Yeah.
And our efforts are also, I think, is important to archive our information properly. We have documents that we're looking at our server. We're looking at really overhauling everything to make sure that, you know, that you don't have just carrying things over year to year.
Right.
And it's, you know, so from top to bottom, we are, as a staff, working on the entire organization and making sure that it's updated and that people are aware and have responsibility for different components of the program, and that at any given time our staff team could step in on something and pick it up for somebody else if they needed mm-hmm. to. That's what we're priding ourselves on now, is getting that cross training and making sure that everyone is up to speed on that.
Well, and too, when you have a defined group or that has a defined time period, mm-hmm. like the AmeriCorps Volunteers, mm-hmm. a day is very important, so you can't really lose a day.
Yep.
Somebody has to be there to.
And the traveling exhibit, I wanted to at least update you on the traveling exhibit of the AmeriCorps program. The end of 2014 will mark the 15th year of AmeriCorps on Cape Cod. And so we had the 15 trees, 15 years program, but we, as a result of that, we moved the exhibit from the Cape Cod National Seashore at the Salt Pond Visitor Center, where it was there in August. So we wanted it to be more observed on different parts of the Cape. So the Potomac Center for the Arts under Andrea York, we put it over there. The exhibit is there. The town of Warren gave us a certificate and thanked us for the service that we do. So all of the posters that will be given to the towns are hanging there, along with the county poster. And I took your advice on the seal. We have that over the 15 towns, so we'll have that for the county commissioners to receive that. So our plan now is, if you agree with this, is that we would approach Janice at the Assembly of Delegates and have the last stop for the exhibit to be there at the Assembly of Delegates. So each one of the posters could be hung up for a period of time, probably, you know, the end of November and December. And then we would coordinate with them to have the representatives that were selected from each town to receive the poster on behalf of the town, to take that back to their town, that we would have that ceremony over there with the assembly, and then the assembly rep and the town representative could say, you know, here's sandwiches, town poster, and they could take it on its way. Now, Janice did say so.
Do I understand you correctly that you're going to have somebody from the assembly actually take something from the county back to their town? Is that what you're intending? Oh, that's wonderful.
But one of the things Janice says, these would be really nice just for us to have to hang up.
Yeah, it would make the whole room look better.
We can do that. We thought it would be nice if we went ahead and let the towns have their framed poster, their big poster, but work with the assembly to have each town's poster there for them, get a whole other set for the towns to have there.
Seriously, there is a question as to where they would put it when they got to the town. You know, the towns have a lot of exhibits and things that are transient, and at least in my experience in going to different town halls, I wonder if there was a prominent enough place where this could be put up in the town. So I think that the idea of having it permanently exhibited at the assembly, meeting place, I think that is probably a more practical way of making sure that that it got the attention, because they are on television, and perhaps they could sort of pan around, just to show, let's say, the connection
The connection to their town is very visible, which is, I think, very good to have.
Yep. So, and then once we get the coordinates set on and all the signage up on the trees, then we'll have the 16 trees that have been planted in. We'll be able to give you the locations, and each AmeriCorps year we'll be able to see their tree.
These are the cedars of Babylon.
Right. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much, darling.
Thank you.
As usual, everybody's doing a lot of work.
Thank you.
Yes.
Okay.
Thanks again.
The resource development stuff. Was you here to report on where they have gone? I don't know.
That's okay. Next.
Oh, okay.
We're going to have out of state travel report.
Okay.
The resource development employees.
Oh, okay.
We have Amanda Howe.
Thank you.
Hello.
Yeah. Managing federal grants and cooperative agreements for recipients.
Yes. Yeah.
Good. A long title with a lot of meaning.
Yes.
So what windowless?
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Good.
Windowless room did you get trapped into? why you went to some sort of exotic place.
It was Tyson's Corner, Virginia, which is just west of DC.
Very close to where I used to live.
So, so this management concepts has lots of programs, lots of courses that they offer. And they offer for, depending on what your track is, we're in the subrecipient track, and so we're following that. We can get a certificate if we take enough courses to be sort of certified in our in grants management, which is great.
Is this the, who's the provider? Is it USDI, Department of Agriculture?
Well, management concepts, I believe, is independent, like a private company. But they have sort of everything under their...
Right, and they are a very well-known company, so it's something a lot of organizations use.
A training company, yeah. So what gems did you bring back from them?
What we did was we made it, this is the outline of what we actually covered, so you can see the level of detail. It was a bit dry, but we had a great instructor. He was really good, and so that kept it interesting for us.
I love these because, you know, there are things that you kind of know, but when they explain them to you, you say, oh, that's, you know, oh.
It's really
it's
helpful.
It's not as hard. Sometimes we overthink these things, or so that's very good.
Well, it's especially timely because there's a new code of federal regulations where they've combined sort of a whole bunch of regulations into one super circular, and so this is effective this December 26th, and so it affects all future federal awards if they come through. So we felt it was really important that we get some people in our department get familiar with this. So this is sort of the first step for us in terms of taking these courses, but there are others that we're looking forward to taking.
This is one of the things they gave you?
Oh, yes. We brought it just in case anybody wanted to look at it. It's just a binder.
Can I take a look?
Yeah.
Thanks.
Of some of the things we went through.
Well, why don't we hear the presentation instead of keep it? We probably answer your questions when they start.
Probably.
Go ahead.
Well, so that was really all.
That was really it.
Just to tell you that we, unless there's something else.
Why don't you talk a bit about how many grants you administer over the course of time here?
Yeah.
And what you're really looking for in terms of grants that would be helpful to the county and AmeriCorps and everything else we do.
Right. Oh, sure. So I'm still fairly new. I started in July with this position, and I had been running the AmeriCorps program for a while before that. And so the biggest thing I'm doing right now is actually managing the AmeriCorps grant. Mm-hmm. And so I'm working on writing that with a couple of other staff members right now for the proposal
for
that Darlene
next
had
3 years.
About. And then I think in January, I'm going to start helping with some of the health, our Human Services Department grants as well. Okay. So those are the big ones I'm going to be working on.
And the AmeriCorps grant is a huge.
Yeah, it is. That's a big
lots
document.
Lots of pieces to it.
Yeah.
Yes, and lots of fun statutes and provisions and.
You're going to learn a lot.
Oh, I've already learned a lot.
Yeah, that's good. That's good. That's great. I'm glad to hear that. So you'll go on. So with this company, can you do continued online training, or do you have to?
They have both.
They have both, and then those will add up towards a certificate.
Yes.
And so how long does it take to get a certificate? Is it like a year?
Is it three years?
It depends. It's they would like you to get it in 3 years. It's 15 course hours.
Okay.
So I think 9 are required and 6 are elective.
Yeah, and then there's so many hours that you've put into it, I guess.
Each course day, I guess.
Right, goes towards some sort of point, process.
Okay.
That's great. Well, continue. Yeah. I think it's great.
Yeah, no question?
No?
And my grants, I mostly work with Bill Clark at the Extension.
Mm-hmm.
That's the majority of my grants. I do some with the Cove, Children's Cove, also some for the Health Department. And it depends. The federal grants are one piece of what we do, but there's also the state and local grants too, so. There's sort of a whole variety of things that we need to be, each one's different and needs to be handled differently.
So really, your concentration here was the AmeriCorps grants, is that the other side?
Well, the HUI project, the HUI C grant is also federal, so that comes to.
So when grants come through, like you're made aware of grants that are available, and do you sort of put those out to the community saying, yeah, because I've gotten some of those things, like there are this human service grant for this, so it's kind of piped out there if there's an organization or a town or a municipal department that's looking at that. And then if they need assistance, they'll call you for those types of, you know, guidance, and now you can give them regulations.
Right, well, both ways, right.
And statutes.
So sometimes they'll reach out to us and sometimes we'll find them and reach out to them.
Right.
And that's what we're really looking for, that with having a new hire for the this summer, I mean, this has been great. We're really happy to have the board like be fully staffed. It's been made a big difference. And so we can really do more.
I think it's an important service, and it's a skill that's that, you know, people take for granted. But it's really important, especially that's how we get so much of our funding now. So I think it's great.
Okay.
Well, good. Well, thank you very much.
Nice shopping down there at Tyson's.
Yes. We saw them all.
Yes, I bet you did. That's a great call.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Right.
Okay.
Thank you.
Bye.
Yeah, thank God for RDO.
Yes, I guess. I'm sure.
They keep me out of trouble. And,
yeah.
Someone has to do that.
Work hard.
Yeah.
Thank you, Commissioners, for RDO.
All right.
Okay, Bill, you and Larry Depsis are next.
All
right. Talk about
tick-borne
disease prevention on the Cape.
Yes, you all know Larry Depsis,
yes,
entomologist and Lyme disease
We've
project
been out
coordinator.
Checking ticks with him before. So.
Yes. With the high incidence of tick-borne illnesses on the Cape, about 15 years ago, we started a tick-related project or projects looking into all the issues with tick-borne illnesses. We focus on educational programs, technical assistance, and research. Mm-hmm. Research has been funded, fortunately been funded, through EPA recently, University of Mass Amherst. We work closely with their tick lab on campus. And we had originally started with funds from the Mass Department of Public Health. So it extends beyond the county, so to speak. We also work with our friends at County Health, George and Deirdre. We collaborate not only together within the departments on projects, but also with the task force that you all appointed, which is a very helpful group, by the way.
Is it? Okay.
They meet at least quarterly, George?
Yes.
Yeah. And it's a great sounding board. They, not all, but several of them come from medical backgrounds. We also have natural resource backgrounds on there, and very helpful in guiding what we do.
And participation from the islands or from the vineyard on
that
task force?
We used to.
Used to, but not so much anymore?
Not so much anymore. It started out that way, but over the years, they sort of doing their own thing. There's always that issue with travel and so forth and making meetings. So we do have, we have had projects on both islands as part of the EPA funding, and prior to that, the Mass Public Health funding. So we've been working on Nantucket and mostly in Chappie on the vineyard. So with that quick introduction, I'll introduce Larry to provide a PowerPoint presentation on what we're doing.
Very good.
Welcome,
Bill,
Larry.
Hopefully you're not going to hurt your neck trying to view these slides.
No, we're kind of used to this.
Oh, okay.
I usually move.
Move up a little closer.
Yeah.
Well, good morning, folks, and
good
thanks
morning.
For giving us the opportunity to kind of give you a quick overview of some of our activities in the area of prevention of tick-borne diseases. Like Bill indicated, you embarked on creating this program 15 years ago, and the reasons you threw a stake in the ground back then are probably still pretty relevant today, and even accentuated by a changing landscape. One thing about tick-borne diseases, this is not a static problem. We have a changing landscape. So as it turns out, if you look at the situation today, Barnstable County, you have the fourth highest incidence rate of Lyme in the state. the good news is that for a long time, you guys were number three. You're losing, okay? And that's a good thing. Plymouth County last year leapfrogged past Barnstable County, where they have now probably twice the incidence rate of Lyme disease than Barnstable. The other situation is that Barnstable County has the third highest incidence rate of an emerging disease, babesiosis. If you look at this disease, which can be quite serious, and unlike Lyme, can be directly fatal, it is on the increase in the state. And if you look at Plymouth County, Barnstable County, and the islands, over half the cases in the state are in southeast Massachusetts.
Could that be because of, it's like in Plymouth, they have the forest there. Is it because of the wooded areas, or is it just because of the location?
Interesting. You're going to see some interesting statistics for Falmouth in a few slides. But we're looking at that ecological question.
The ecology of this is very complex.
Of the area.
There's a lot of moving parts.
Bill, you had a question.
The Farm Bureau has many members that just have horses, as far as activity. So there are a lot of horses on the Cape. And it's been brought to my attention that horses are very susceptible to Lyme disease.
Oh, they are indeed.
And indeed, what happens is that they, when the farriers are shoeing them, they find that they have trouble manipulating their
mm-hmm. They have arthritis. Legs.
Yeah. So I'm wondering if you're getting any expressions of concern from the many equestrian owners here in the Cape.
Occasionally, I talk to people about maybe doing something with insecticide treated leggings for their horses, mm-hmm. and trying, there's some simple things I think they can do to help. All right.
Okay. Keep going.
Yeah. So yeah. I kind of look at our program, I'm coming from 28 years of corporate experience, so I look at our program as a consumer product. So our challenge is to keep our product relevant and value added. If I was going to put a label on our product, it'd probably be something like this. We really have a community wellness program, okay? Anything we can do to better educate people about what ticks are, how they make their living, the consequences of getting disease, those are good things. Everybody we prevent from getting a tick bite and a tick-borne disease, that's a victory, okay? If you look at the socioeconomic costs of things like Lyme disease, the medication, the doctor's visits, the long-term consequences, losing work time, school time, losing work completely sometimes, there's a big impact. So we look at individual people as victories. All right, our program has two prongs to it, research and outreach. All right, as Bill indicated, 15 years ago, you also started this task force, which was originally the Cape and Island Lyme Disease Task Force. But now you can see it's been expanded to the Tick-Borne Diseases Task Force, chaired by Brenda Bolin, Henry Lind, the shellfish growers on there, a couple doctors, a couple nurses, and Bill, George, Deidre, and myself as a supporting cast. A lot of the activities are focused on two areas with the task force. One is legislation monitoring. So occasionally we'll have people from Dan Wolf's office, Bill Keating's office, kind of give us an overview of what's going on, whether or not the task force should be weighing in, providing letters of support on different things. So it's a way to keep us informed. As Bill indicated, they're also involved in outreach development. Okay, this group is a great sounding board for the programs that Deidre and I manage. So we can bounce a lot of things. They'll bring things to our attention. Hey, if you consider it, yada, yada, yada. So they've been good. The other activity that is quite beneficial and unique is the task force has sponsored physicians forums. All right, we've done this now 3 years in a row, and the task force is committed to developing a more tick-borne disease literate medical community, because there's work that needs to be done in that regard. So we'll host these at, I think they've been at the Hyannis
Golf Club.
Mm-hmm. And we'll invite all the doctors from the KP Islands. We'll bring in top-notch researchers from places like Johns Hopkins, Columbia, Stony Brook. So we're serving up what is the latest research going on in the area of tick-borne diseases? And I think it's been very well received. All right. We talked about this being a changing landscape. All right. This is a new player in town. This is a lone star tick. And this creature's been moving steadily northward for the last 25 years. A number of ecologists think it's due to, you know, it's one of the functions of climate change. Up to this point, the furthest northern established populations have been found on Cuddy Hunk Island off the coast of the Vineyard and Prudence Island off the coast of Rhode Island. Well, Sandy Neck Beach Park is a barrier beach habitat in West Barnstable and Sandwich. And Cape Cod Mosquito Control works that neighborhood. And last summer they called me. Their people were seeing something different in Sandy Neck, and not on the beach, but in the uplands. There's about 700 acres of uplands. And they were seeing a different tick. So I went out there with them, and I sampled at five different points about 3 miles apart, and I was finding lone star tick, adults in nymph stage. So we suspected we may have an established population. We went back there this fall and looked for, that's when lone star tick eggs hatch into larvae, and we found tick larvae from stem to stern. So we've got hard evidence that we have found the first established population of lone star on the Massachusetts mainland. Now this is a little bit different tick than we're used to. It's an aggressive biter, all right? Deer ticks wait for dinner to come to them. You brush up against them, they attach. These guys can see you and they can run. They will chase you, okay? Mm-hmm. And they are fast. The first time one attached my leg, and I saw it run completely, it was a little scary. Now, these guys don't transmit Lyme, but they've got their own set of diseases. Ehrlichiosis, starry, a type of rash with flu-like symptoms, tularemia. And the real difference maker here is, it is now known that this can trigger an allergy to red meat consumption. All right, and this allergy can take the form from hives all the way to anaphylactic shock. Okay, now that they know they can test for this, they've done a lot of research down in Virginia, they've uncovered several thousand cases of this, and they don't know how long it lasts. They don't know if you have it forever or if eventually it goes away. So we're going to greatly expand our surveillance efforts. We don't know if we're dealing with something fairly contained, but we're going to start doing intensive surveillance inside and outside of the park. All right, we do a lot of outreach, as Bill said. We do a number of events, and we do a number of workshops. Since the month of May, I've done 50 workshops or events. We've been in outreach overdrive. So this happens to be the Sandwich Daffodil Festival, where we had a display table. Great chance for one-on-one engagement. So while kids are coloring these really cool bug pictures and walking off with my crayons, it's a way I can really, you know, engage with people one-on-one and directly. These venues are particularly good because we need to do a better job of reaching soccer moms and soccer dads. If you look at the age distribution of something like Lyme, kids age 5 to 9 are the highest incidence rate of all demographics. We also do classroom workshops. Our AmeriCorps kids, Every year, I have a chance to work with them. We do a lot of library programs, senior centers, community centers. The AmeriCorps group is important in a couple ways. One is, some of these people come from areas of the country where tick-borne diseases are not that prevalent, okay? So my job is to scare the daylights out of them. And I'm very good at this by now. And then reassure them that all is not lost. Don't go running home. We can help. And so once I scare them, I have their full attention on what's, because these people spend a lot of time in tick habitat, okay? They're in harm's way. And they're an awesome group to work with. All right. One of the aspects of our workshops is we show them aspects of our research. we have had an EPA-funded project for the last 5 years, and one component of this is to look at distribution and rates of tick infection. And just to show you a couple of our sites, the Punkhorn in Brewster and Bell's Neck in Harwich. The way we read this chart is that the first column, and this is nymph stage tick, and this is important here. We spend a lot of focus on this. This is a stage that's the size of a poppy seed that's out during the summer months. The nymph stage is responsible for 85% of all tick-borne diseases. So if we look at the first column, percent infection with Borrelia, that's Lyme. So we see infection rates anywhere from 20 to, you know, over 30% of ticks carrying Lyme disease. But look at this middle column. Babesia causes babesiosis. We're seeing infection rates with babesia that are on par with Lyme, okay? And we presented some of these data at one of the physicians' forums several years ago, and the doctors almost fell out of their chairs. They had no idea that these other diseases were as prevalent as they are. We find anaplasma as well, but at typically at lower levels. And we also see a certain level of co-infection. On average, 7 to 9% of the nymph stage ticks are packing Lyme plus one of these other creatures. So this landscape has been shifting for a number of years now, and actually presents a fairly scary picture. All right, we've got another player that we're now looking at, Borrelia miyamotoi, okay? This is so new, it doesn't even have an official name for a disease. The organism's been known about for a while, and it was only until 2 years ago that they've tied this thing, which is vectored by deer ticks, to human disease. Once this was known, they found U.S. cases that were being misdiagnosed as anaplasmosis. And they did start seeing this on places like Nantucket. We have a big collaboration with Steve Rich, Laboratory of Medical Zoology at UMass Amherst, and he is now analyzing for this pathogen in our tick samples. And we found that this year, in about 3% of our ticks. So it's here, it's probably been here for a while, we just didn't know to look for it. But this is something else that's on the radar screen. We do know that Cape Cod Hospital has diagnosed at least a dozen cases of this year. All right, we spend a lot of time talking about prevention tactics with people. This one, tick repellent clothing using the active ingredient permethrin, this is the most effective tool in the box. This is something used to treat clothing, including footwear, because those nymph stage ticks are down in the leaf litter. It bonds the fabric very tightly, so it will retain its activity through 6 different washings. And there's a number of different brands, Benz, Coleman, Sawyer, they're all the same, okay? What I have found in working with this product is that if it'll repel a tick, but if a tick is on a treated surface for 60 seconds, on average, that tick is dead in about 9 minutes. You do this alone, you've reduced your chances of getting a tick bite by 90%. Here was the problem, though, finding it. When I came here 3.5 years ago, if you even knew about this product, you could only get it at Eastern Mountain Sports. So what I started doing was talking to garden centers and hardware stores. I wanted to expand points of distribution because as I'm talking about this, I want to make it so easy for people to find it. Well, this is where you can find it now. It's got fairly broad distribution. I do store checks, and just to make sure we still have product on shelf, this happens to be Scenic Roots and Sandwich. Not only did they have product on shelf, but they paired it with our printed literature. So gold star for them. So the other store managers, when I go and I talk to them, is product moving? And they say, yes, people are coming in asking for it. So the word is getting out. All right, so what we've done is we've constructed a very simplified game plan for people. If you look at a number of traditional extension programs on preventing tick-borne diseases, they'll give you a laundry list of 10 to 15 things to do. Move your wood piles, move your bird feeders, put up deer fencing, unless something has scientific-based evidence to support it, we don't talk about it, all right? Our program is built on evidence-based science. So we give people a three-point plan. Protect yourself, take chicks and permethrin-treated clothing, perimeter yard spray as appropriate, and protect your pets. 1, 2, 3. So we are giving people a program that they're empowered to actually execute today, okay? All right, there was a person from Cape Cod Healthcare that attended one of my workshops, Lisa Gion, and apparently she enjoyed it because she called Bill Clark up the next day and said, hey, we want to give you guys some money. We like what you're doing. So they shot $2,000 our way, and Bill and I talked about how to use it, and we used to, you know, distribute trail signs, okay? And if you drive, as I drive around, I see a number of them up there. They were weather fade, you know, they're faded, they're broken. So we decided, let's revise this. So we came up with this. Something that shows the actual size of the ticks, the diseases they carry, simple prevention tactics, our branded message, and co-branded with Cape Cod Healthcare. So we had 1,000 of these made. So we've got 600 that have been distributed. All the state parks have them, Sandy Neck. They've been delivered to all the town conservation offices. And we've now contacted ComCAC of Cape Cod Conservation Land Trust and offered the remaining 400 to them. So we expect they're going to take probably most of them. All right, the other program we began this year, we're collaborating with three other counties on a state-funded program, the Community Innovation Challenge Grant. And what this is, it involves tick testing, okay, with the Laboratory of Medical Zoology at UMass. So there's four counties, 32 towns represented, and the $110,000 that we receive will basically pay completely the cost of testing 100 ticks on average per town. So there's no charge to the submitter. Normally this is a $50 test. So it gives people hard data, okay? We talk about this with people that if you can get that tick tested and you can see what you were exposed to, that's good data when you talk to your doctor, okay? Because one of the things I find is that people are very frustrated that when they get a tick bite, they talk to their doctor, and they're kind of getting nowhere. But now they can basically say, hey, I was exposed to this, but I was also exposed to this. So it's good stuff. And what this allows us to do is we can use these data to develop maps of exposure risk. And Steve Rich just started dropping data from this into mapping software, and we're seeing some interesting pictures. Here's Falmouth. If you look at this, these are the people that submitted ticks into this program. If you look at Babesia-infected ticks, well, those are the markers in red. And if you look, all the Babesia detects are at the very western edge of the town. And we don't know why. Okay, Steve and I are talking about this right now. What's different about this area ecologically that's different than here or the interior of the town? So it raises a lot of interesting questions about how these diseases are distributed in different environments.
It's also on one side of 28 going down there.
Yeah.
On the highway. Just, it hasn't seemed to cross over.
Just one on the other side. But yeah, you're right. It's very localized to the edge of the town. All right, we've got a few projects pending. All right, one is Cape Cod Healthcare has a community benefits grant program. There are four areas they're considering funding projects. One is tick-borne diseases. So we've applied for it, and if funded, we're going to do a tick education direct marketing to all households. 150 households on the Cape.
50,000.
150,000. And this is something that we're very excited about, feel very good about our chances of getting it. We should know this month. The tick testing program, we're going for round two, okay, on this. And one aspect of this is greatly enhancing the scope of work. We're adding Plymouth County into this and Hampshire County. So we're going from 32 towns to 75 towns. That represents 23% of all towns in the Commonwealth. The idea here is to basically have enough volume going into Steve's lab. So we're pitching this as a business plan. CIC monies as an investment in state institution infrastructure to reduce unit cost of tick testing. So we're participating in a big way, but at the end of the day, if this plays out, it provides our stakeholders on in Barnstable County a sustainable, low-cost availability of a valuable service. And last, we were approached by EPA to put in a project request for their Region 1 RESIS program, Research Sustainability Environmental Science. And we're pitching Lone Star tick trapping. I started looking at developing a monitoring system for Lone Star last year using a trap baited with dry ice. So we think we can develop a more efficient way to look for these guys. We're going to do this regardless of EPA funding or not. A lot of this would go into Steve Rich's program, Small Mammal Trapping Study. This is a way to figure out who is carrying these diseases. Is it the mice carrying all three? Is it shrews? Is it voles? Is it chipmunks? We're trying to characterize the ecological structure of these places. All right, and that is it. So that's a thumbnail walk through our program.
That's very good. Questions? Bring forward now.
That's Bill.
This is almost winter. We're getting close to winter. And I think that people start to get a sort of a warm, fuzzy feeling that they're not, or that the exposure is going to be less. And anecdotally, I remember putting out Christmas lights, you know, after Thanksgiving and coming back loaded with ticks because there's been a change in the weather down here.
Mm-hmm.
What do you tell people about, the exposure that they might get during this time of year with regard to infection?
I show people an interesting chart that shows number of cases of Lyme disease by month for the whole year. And when I throw the chart up there, I tell people it shows you a couple different things. Because people ask me when's tick season. I say it starts in January, ends in December, and starts up again in January. So the risk of a tick-borne bite is year-round. And people, especially this year, were asking me about, Larry, that harsh, harsh winter we had, what did it do to the tick populations? Well, harsh winter is a discretionary term. The winters here aren't that harsh. So I tell people about my 24 years of traveling to Wisconsin, where winters are typically 25 below zero. Deer ticks are just happy, happy, happy because deer ticks synthesize glycerol. They make antifreeze. So the cold weather doesn't impact. So when you get temperatures above freezing and no snow cover, they're there.
Which is the point I was trying to make.
Yeah.
And we don't know what brings that particular group of ticks here, then do we? What species might bring it, or why they happen to be here and they weren't here before?
What, the deer ticks?
Yeah, the new one, the Lone Star.
Oh, Lone Star.
Yeah, how did it happen to get here?
I believe it was probably brought in by migratory birds.
Well, by birds.
Yeah, birds are really good dispersal agents for ticks.
Hmm. Well, the coastline is obviously a good place for migratory birds, so maybe that's why they're more along the coastline in West Falmouth here.
So if you look at where, I mean, eastern Long Island, Lone Star is really thick in there. And I'm sure, you know, that flyway from Long Island to Elizabeth Islands and up to Sandy Neck. So we're going to actually look at other barrier beach habitats this next year.
Years ago, we tested ticks that were on birds. We actually worked with the Cape Cod Museum of Natural History in Princeton, and they have a banding program set up. So when they were banding the birds, they would remove the ticks for us. So we would keep a population count as well as test them to see what diseases they were carrying.
Yeah, a number of birds, like our American robin, are host reservoirs for Lyme disease.
Mm-hmm. And then we're seeing more attention being paid to it. We've talked about legislation that, you know, that would help. There seems to continue to be a disconnect between the credibility that doctors find in diagnosis and what's going on. Is there any change in that?
There's a couple things going on. One is it's clearly identified that a better diagnostic tool is needed. The ones that are there are not reliable. You can get false positives, you can get false negatives. So it's an area that people understand has to be, you need a breakthrough, some way, somehow. Now, there was a bill that just made it through the House that basically forms a task force. So now there's going to be a way to develop a strategic plan at a national level. So this group that's formed is going to better connect federal agencies about how to organize approaches to solving a problem like diagnostics.
Okay, excuse me, I just was a follow-up. Yeah. We had a, I seem to recall that when Brenda Boyle was still active with us, there
still
was
is.
Legislation. Oh, good.
Oh, yeah.
She's chair.
She's coming over from Duxbury now.
Mm-hmm.
In any case, there was a task force formed, I thought. There
yes.
was legislation. Is this a continuation of that task force?
Yes. Or is it, no, this is a federal one.
Oh, no, it's a state one.
Yeah. There was a state Lyme commission, Massachusetts Lyme commission. They worked on this for a few years, coordinating efforts. But this one is at the federal level.
Okay. Is there, and this is always the important thing, the hope is that they're not, the feds are not starting from scratch, that they're integrating the activity that's gone on before, the data that we've collected, into their activity, so that we get the benefit of that as far as expanding it. And then adding on to that, if the federal government is now interested in it, this is no longer a Cape Cod problem.
Oh, sure.
How far does the radius go in New England with regard to this problem?
We're what's considered an endemic area, okay? If you look at where Lyme is endemic, it's endemic from the mid-Atlantic states up to southern Maine, out to New York and Pennsylvania, and the upper central Midwest, western Michigan, Wisconsin, and Minnesota. There are 13 states that account for 95% of all cases of Lyme. But Lyme has also been found in 49 out of 50 states. It's been found in 80 countries around the world. So it's not something that started in Lyme, Connecticut and radiated outward. It's not a new problem, it's a resurgent problem.
And so you already said the doctors need a better diagnostic tool in order to evaluate properly. Is there any talk about the reintroduction of a vaccine? Because there was one.
There was.
I remember paying to get it years ago.
Yeah, it was pulled from the market in 2002. And Baxter Pharmaceutical is developing a vaccine. In fact, they're in phase two clinical trials in Europe right now. But the problem with that is that you just can't vaccinate your way out of this problem now, because you have babesiosis, you have anaplasmosis, and Miyamotoi, and who knows what else, because what we do know about ticks is they're little dirty hypodermic needles.
Okay, well, let's live in hope.
It's not a pleasant name, that.
Use your Bermuda quilt.
Thank you.
Great. Well, thank you very much, Bill and Larry and George. That was very helpful. Okay, so before we go into executive session, we need to do a little business first. The first would be to approve the minutes of October 22nd and October 29th regular session minutes. Hello? I need a motion to approve the minutes of October 22nd and October 29th.
Okay, she just moved, I'll second it.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye, opposed, unanimous. And the executive session minutes of October 29th.
I'll move those.
Which we did not have last second. Okay. And not to release. The motion would include and not to release.
I'll amend my motion to include that language.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye, opposed, unanimous. Michael, did you have anything you wanted to report on?
I did, actually.
Okay.
George is here today. I've asked him to attend because you have in your package a grant regarding community septic loan program. And George can give you a little bit more information, but it's a very large item.
Okay.
Well, it's essentially the $5 million loan that we take under the septic loan program.
Right.
Paperwork you have in front of you is really just sort of a refashioning of another document that you've already signed. It's sort of a new form. As you know, we borrow money under the SRF. I think it's got a new name to it now for loaning out to the public. We've borrowed $5 million and actually spent the $5 million. It's out in loans right now. The last bit, $200,000 loan was finished up in July. So that document you signed, you really have essentially signed before, but this is a new form of it. We've done about $1 million this quarter, and from here on in, we will probably use for, hence the word revolving loan, we'll be using the money being paid back to us, the principal paid back to us. I'm going to be a poor substitute on being able to assure you that everything is fine because Mark was typically the one, and Joanne, who know exactly how much we're getting paid back, at what rate, and therefore safely loan back out. But I believe that we will not go back to the state for a loan at this point. They've changed their policy from 0% loan to a 2% loan. But we've already loaned out so much in money that we're getting payments back that we can revolve that and get it right back out.
So, is it in the blue folder? Could you find it, Bill, if you would, please?
We continue to serve primarily residential loans, and as you know, you've already approved some set aside of funds that we've received back for loaning mom and pop operations, and we've made three of those loans, completing another one fairly soon.
So do I understand you to say that any additional loans will be a 2% and not zero?
Any that we go to the state for, yes, will be a 2%.
And as of,
you will recall that we loan the money to homeowners at 5% at this point.
Right.
And that any sort of differences between loan request and paybacks, we've set aside some money to loan to mom and pop operations, which under the strict rules of the septic loan program would not be allowed using state loan money.
Can this wait till next week? Is that possible? Because we really haven't had an opportunity yet to review this. And
I'm in no hurry.
I mean, I think it's important. It is part of the state revolving fund, and they've changed the terms. So I think we really need to
change the terms for any future loan.
Right.
This one here, I will say, as I said before, the money has already been loaned. This is sort of the final signature saying, "Yep, we have the money. We've loaned it all out." And anything after this, when we go to them for monies, would be at the 2% rate. However, we don't anticipate having to going back to that well. We just don't anticipate having to go back to it for quite a while, if at all.
Commissioners, that's a Treasury compliance report that basically says this is, you've received this amount of money, you've spent it, and it's in compliance.
Oh, this is something we've already spent.
Correct.
This isn't something going
already forward.
No. Okay.
I understand. I make a motion that we sign.
Okay. This, because this 2% does not affect this, whatever
correct.
We're signing here.
Right.
Okay.
2%.
So do you want to include this in there?
I will include it. So
okay.
Do you want to?
I'll move the summary of actions.
And that will be included. Do you want to move the summary of actions then? Oh, you want to second it?
I'll second it.
Okay. All right. Then all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Unanimous. Thank you. That's
if
good.
You'd like at some point, I can have Kendall run down the.
No, but I think we should have a discussion at some point, maybe with you and Kendall, on what are we going to do going forward now that it's 2%.
Yeah, I don't think the discussion would be necessary for at least a year, if not more. However, if you'd like to have that discussion, of course, for you just
well, I think as we approach a new budget year, it doesn't have to be, you know, this month or next month, but sometime surely before we submit a budget in February, we should have the discussion.
Yes, it appears that we're running at about $1 million a quarter loaning out.
Mm-hmm.
We have a very low default rate, and
yeah, it's been a very successful program. There's no question.
Well, the low default rate is set because we essentially have a super lien on any properties that would try to default, but we haven't had to pull that card out except for very few cases.
So, when would you anticipate that we might be applying for additional funds under the new rate?
If anytime? At all, it would be a year out, at least a year out. If at all. What we're finding is that there's a pretty high rate of early paybacks, people paying mm-hmm. it off early. So, of course, that brings the principal money back in, which we then loan right back out. Recently, there's been quite a spate of folks who pay back early, so that money just gets loaned right back out. The only money that is sort of diverted from that particular stream would be money that we have received back in interest that exceeds the cost of actually running the program. And as I mentioned before, you have okayed that to be used for septic loans to mom and pop or small business operations meeting certain criteria to repair their septic systems because the original monies could not be used for that. One other program that you okayed is people who are creative enough to want eco toilets or composting toilets within their house. We have a very good incentive at a 0% loan for those individuals, provided they have fail systems. And in the coming years, what we'd like to work with is trying to figure out, as towns may or may not adopt alternative on-site systems for compliance with regulations or TMDLs or nutrient sort of management goals, that we would like to see introduced into legislation a redefinition of the word failure, since we're bound by having a system that's failed in accordance with Title V, which has pretty strict guidelines. They're pretty crude. If water's on top of the ground or backing up into the house, that's a clear indication they're failed. But in context of nutrient management, the failure might have a broader definition, which is not reducing nutrients. So we'd like to see that. That's where we'll probably go in the coming year to try to see what the avenues for introduction of legislative changes for that, for not only the tax breaks, but for use of the original SRF funds.
Bill?
It was my understanding that this is a self-sustaining program in terms of covering the overhead of running it.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it is.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So one of the concerns that I'd have is that as this winds down, you have some plan for transitioning, you know, the people in the program to something else.
Well, that's a rather large assumption that it would wind down. we don't see any drop. In fact, we keep seeing an increase in the sort of the interest in the program. But at this point, I've not sat down and said, okay, what are we going to do with these staff members as that occurs?
Okay.
My crude estimate would be that we'll see attrition via retirement long before we're going to see a drop off in the interest of the program. Because remember, the program not only funds septic systems for people who have no credit or have difficulty putting systems in, but every one of the sort of centralized and decentralized options that might be picked by a town, there is some support for that. Obviously, we're not going to better their betterment. But there are people who, for instance, connect to collective systems. That connection is a cost, and we've already funded some, for instance, in Provincetown and other areas, Barnstable, for people to connect to it. So there's a betterment in that regard. So I don't see a drop-off in it. Maybe it's because my window of sight is rather shallow, but I don't see the interest going down at all.
So again, how much is would be available still under the 0%? How much in the program now is still available under the 0%?
I'm sorry I couldn't give you that number,
okay.
But our estimate based on going $1 million a quarter is I don't even have to think about that for at least a year,
okay.
And probably more than that.
Okay.
Because it's we had tried at one point to get somebody to, I hate to use this word, but to model what the payback with all of those sort of bounds on uncertainty, which are how many defaults will you get, how many early paybacks will you get, how fast can you turn the money around. It was complicated enough that I looked and said, you know, the crude model of asking Joanne how much is there, we know our fixed costs for running the program, how much is getting paid back, crudely what the rate of payback is, and how much in the way of funding we have available in hand now. And that sort of crude back the envelope, sit down with a cup of coffee, says, I'm not gonna worry about it for a year. And that's very, very conservative.
I appreciate that, but I do think that, you know, in talking, that's not bad information I have, and maybe going over with some people at the tech.
There is a careful
There is, I'm sure we could sort of figure out some sort of system or a model that could help you really see a clear picture and, you know, with all of the data in there. I'm not saying, you know, I'm just saying I think that would be a good thing
to pursue. It's definitely beyond my brain, but apparently beyond some of the analysts that have presently looked and tried to give the county an estimate of what that would take to get. And many of them backed away saying there are a lot of uncertainties here, a lot of bounds, mm-hmm. a lot of unknowns.
And there's no fixed cost
they
or request either,
be,
so you really don't.
Well, the only thing we do have is the fixed cost to run the program. We know that.
Right. I meant of the
but
requests.
What's really uncertain is how many people will come to your loans, how big will the loans, what will the payback rate be? Plus, there are a lot of differences in rates that occur. If somebody starts to go into default or doesn't make some payments, well, then that interest rate bumps to 14%. Well, you know, are you going to really kill anybody for 14% who missed so many payments? There might be hardship involved. We look at the hardships case by case. We bring some things before you in that regard. So there are enough uncertainties that I guess my approach and the problem is if a crude estimate gets you there, it doesn't kill you, use it. But if you would like that, Mark had set about as well as did Joanne. Mark and Joanne set about with some of the folks that we presently contract with for banking services, we could reinvestigate that. But they pretty much indicated that this would be significant enough that they did not want to embark on that particular course of action. This next year, the only other cost that is coming is we are, since the program has grown so fast, we're looking into a new accounting program that will mesh better with our present accounting program here at the county to allow faster reconciliation of the books. We do it and our audits are flawless, but we realized that the program we're using, which was really an in-house program that we wrote, I say we, but I wouldn't be able to write three sentences of it. But that program is really at its bounds, and we want to expand the service for people to have maximum flexibility in payback plans, monthly, quarterly, those separate options, which can add uncertainty to the payback, as well as paying by credit card, paying by phone, doing whatever they have to do to make the payments.
Could I ask, you did say that some of this money you have set aside or have given to people who want to retrofit, so they have a failed system and now they want to go to an alternative septic system, to a compost, say.
That was the only alternative I did mention to you. Nobody has, by the way.
Oh, nobody has, because I was going to say, how long does it take?
That was the question.
If I had a failed system and I said, well, you know what, now that it's failed, I'm going to go do this other thing. I mean, do we have, so we don't know how much time that would take to have a new system up and running.
Well, under existing regulations, you can take a semi-failed Title V system, feed gray water, and get your composting toilet installed as quick as you could get a builder to do it. And the loan, we execute a loan within a week.
Okay.
And frankly, it's faster than that.
Okay. Interesting.
Any other questions? Thank you, George.
Okay, so if you'd like Kendall to come and give you the full picture, and it would be good if we had the wisdom of Mark to better outline, man's got to know his limits, and mine is that.
Right.
Being able to really give you the exact figures requested.
Okay.
Thank you.
Great.
Thank you very much. Michael, do you have any other items to report?
I do not.
Anybody else, Bill?
No, not really. I would like to get some water before we start into executive session.
Some what?
Some water.
Oh, water.
I'll be right back.
Are you adjourning?
No, we're...
You probably start the process.
Why don't let us go into executive session and you can get your water. Because I don't... All right, so I need a motion.
I'd like to move to go into executive session, reading the protocol. This seems like, you know, like a mass on Sunday where you read the, anyway. Motion to convene executive session under Mass General Laws, Chapter 30A, Section 21A6, to consider the purchase of real property in such that an open session may have a detrimental effect on the negotiating position of the county and not to reconvene in open session.
I second that motion.
Okay, all in favor by roll call?
Lyon, aye.
Flynn, aye.